This is Vista Records Radio. Welcome to a special edition of Vista Records Radio on hightechradio.com and YouTube. My name is Erik Rupp, and I am your host. On this special edition of Vista Records Radio, we are going to have the first in a series of special editions about bands that should have been huge. Well, if not huge, they should have at least been way more successful than they were. Now, the first band we're going to be looking at, they started in the 70s, but really peaked in the early to mid-80s, and I'm talking about Y&T. Now, the Y&T that we all know started in 1974 as Yesterday and Today, when guitarist-singer Dave Menichetti and drummer Leonard Hayes brought in bass player Phil Kennamore and rhythm guitar player Joey Alves. They started writing original songs. They were a hard rockin' band in San Francisco. That was unusual at the time. San Francisco's bands were typically really laid back, kind of like the Grateful Dead. The Grateful Dead, Santana, that kind of thing. And Y&T went out there playing like Led Zeppelin and Montrose, heavy on the Montrose influence. And they were doing something that most bands in that area were not doing. They made a big name for themselves doing that, and they ended up getting signed to London Records. Now, their first two albums, their self-titled debut album came out in 1976, and then Struck Down, their second album, came out in 1978. Neither one of those albums made a dent on the charts. Neither one of them had any kind of impact. But that first album had one of their signature songs on it. It is a track that they play live to this day. It is a classic, and it's called 25 Hours a Day. Well, you took me in, you loved me like I've never been loved before. You took me and squeezed me like I've never been squeezed before. Now I come around your house, just asking for a little more. Clearly, Yesterday and Today was a band that was on the right track. They had the right style. They had some of the right songs. But they weren't quite there, and London was not the right record company to break them to the big time. So after their relationship with London ended, they signed to A&M Records. They shortened their name to Y&T and put out a landmark album called Earthshaker. It was still raw. It was unpolished. It was hard rocking for the time, really heavy. Kind of fit in with the new wave of British heavy metal. The British fans really dug this band and dug this album, and the American market was just starting to clue in on who Y&T was and how great they were. And one of the tracks that hit them the most was Hurricane. So the foundation was in place. They had created a cult following, they had started a fan base, but the band, their management, and their record company, they all knew they needed to step it up to the next level. So they had them, the record company had them, go to England, and they worked with Max Norman, who had just done the first two Ozzy Osbourne solo albums, Blizzard of Oz and Diary of a Madman, and they had the band work with him at Ridge Farm Studios, and the album came out brilliantly. It was called Black Tiger. Max Norman came in, really polished up the band's sound without making them any wimpier, and they then had some songs that still had that edge. They were still heavy, but they also had some songs that were radio-friendly. A track like this is a great example of something radio-friendly from Y&T. It was called Don't Want to Lose. 'Cause you got all I want. So when it came to making the band more radio-friendly, it was definitely mission accomplished for Max Norman on Black Tiger. There were songs on there that were more melodic, more radio-friendly, and of course the album as a whole has a much more polished sound. But there's plenty out there that's high-energy, high-power, kick-ass hard rock, and this is a great example. It's the opening track on the album. It's called Open Fire. Are we long gonna find out for what we do? And when I get it up, gonna spend some time with you. Hammer some phone, gonna shoot my guns in the sky. Now you know, oh, it's easy to fly. I'm flying high. Open fire. When I hit the stage, gonna open fire. All over this place, open fire. In a rocket rage, oh, I'm gonna open fire.
Despite being more radio friendly and having several Y&T classics like Open Fire, Forever, and the title track Black Tiger, the album itself was not a hit in the United States. It did underperform to the band and the record company's expectations. Now, in the UK and Great Britain, the album was a minor hit. It did hit number 53 on the album charts in the UK, but in the United States, it did not make an impact. So the band went back to the drawing board, brought in a new producer, Chris Sangarides, who had worked with Thin Lizzy and Judas Priest in the past, and they brought him in to produce the next album, which would become Mean Streak. Mean Streak, in a lot of people's opinion, is the high watermark for the band. It is just a phenomenal album. Some people would say it's a perfect Y&T album. It's got a ton of classics. The audio production is outstanding, even maybe a notch better than Black Tiger. And the album is just loaded with classics, including this one, the title track, Mean Streak. She got a mean streak, but you never so much you don't want to see. Mean Streak also saw A&M finally give Y&T some money for a promo video, which they filmed for the title track, and that video got some airplay on MTV. Not a ton, but it got some airplay and helped build their audience. And that's where it stopped. There wasn't any follow-up from A&M. They didn't release any more singles. They didn't give them any money for any more videos. Whereas a band like Van Halen got multiple videos as early as 1978 from Warner Brothers, A&M was kind of being stingy with Y&T. They didn't give them any more money for a second video for the album. They didn't give them a second single release. God only knows why, because they had a great single ready to go. And the album had built on the audience that Black Tiger really helped build up. Black Tiger was not a big hit, but it did build their audience, and it widened it a little bit, and Mean Streak was doing even more, and A&M just failed to build on that. And the single that should have been released after Mean Streak was this one, Breaking Away. A promise we can buy. With A&M failing to promote Mean Streak the way they should have, the album did not sell a whole lot more than Black Tiger. Yes, it sold more. Yes, it built their audience, but it could have been a much bigger seller had A&M really pushed it. It easily should have been a gold album, if not platinum, but A&M did not give it the kind of promotion that it needed to get there. So the band went back to the drawing board yet again, this time enlisting Judas Priest producer Tom Allom to produce the next album, which became In Rock We Trust. Now, the irony of the situation is In Rock We Trust really was the weakest album under the YNT name to date, but it was also their most successful, and it would become their most successful album of their entire career thanks to this song, the lead single, Don't Stop Running. Now, while In Rock We Trust isn't YNT's strongest album up to that point, it did have some really good songs on it. You know, Don't Stop Running being one of them, Lipstick and Leather, which got a low-budget video, that being another one. There was some good stuff on the album, but just wasn't up to the standards of the last three albums before that. But even with that, it was their biggest-selling album ever, and they were doing really well, and then that's when things really got weird. They put out a live album, Open Fire, and they had a studio song on there as a single. And that studio song did very well on MTV and on the radio. It was Summertime Girls. The album itself was not a big seller, live albums often are not. So what the record company and the band went along with was including the studio version of Summertime Girls on their next album as well. So it was on two albums in a row, which probably didn't help the follow-up album, which was called Down for the Count. It didn't help that at all. And then Down for the Count had some more pop stuff. It was produced by Kevin Beamish, who was best known at that point for producing REO Speedwagon's massively successful High Infidelity album, as well as producing Jefferson Starship. So he was able to give two or three of the songs more of a pop sensibility than they would have had otherwise. And the album itself was really accessible to a wide audience because it did have some good heavy stuff on there as well as the slicker pop stuff. But A&M was not able to find an audience for it, and so the album just tanked. Now, part of the reason A&M couldn't find an audience for it is because they didn't really try that hard. They did not push Down for the Count much at all. And then, of course, it had the single from the previous live album, which people had already bought the live album to get the song. They already owned the song, didn't need to get the new album to get the song again. So the album just went nowhere. A&M didn't push it very hard, and the relationship between A&M and YNT was over. A new year would bring a new record contract for YNT, this one with Geffen Records, as they were signed by the legendary John Kolodner. Now, this was a label that would have massive success with accessible hard rock that year. YNT thought for sure that this was it. They were going to rise from the ashes and have their big commercial success at last. They kept producer Kevin Beamish, and they, for the first time, worked with outside songwriters. The album was slick, but still had a good crunchy guitar tone. They thought for sure they found a way to appeal to a wider audience that would finally bring them some gold and platinum. Unfortunately, just as the album took off, the album was called Contagious, and as soon as it took off, the record company stopped promoting. That year, Geffen Records was focused on three bands when it came to rock: Aerosmith, Whitesnake, and this new band named Guns N' Roses. YNT got left behind. They were forgotten about. They were the band, they had their shot, they never made it. We're going to focus on these three bands that we know we can have massive success with. So YNT once again found a record company that had the ability, but not the will, to push them to gold and platinum status. And their last shot at big success was over. Wow. Now, obviously, Y&T's story doesn't end there. They put one more album out on Geffen a couple of years later called 10, really good album. Geffen did almost nothing to promote it, and of course, it didn't go anywhere either. And then the band split up for a few years before getting back together, doing a couple albums in the 90s, doing an album around 2010. Sadly, three of the original members of the band, Phil Kennemore, Leonard Hayes, and Joey Alves, have all passed away. But Dave Menichetti, lead vocals, lead guitar, underrated at both. He still carries on with the current lineup of the band that sounds fantastic. They are threatening to put out a new album, and if they do, you know it's going to be good. But Y&T is one of those bands that, yeah, they weren't hugely successful. You know what, though? They put out great albums, did great live shows. That's what really counts. And right now I'm going to play you a full song. This is one of their signature songs. Comes off of Black Tiger. It's called Forever.
Thank you.
Y&T closing out this very special edition of Vista Records Radio with Forever from their great Black Tiger album, which came out in 1982. And that's it. That's the end of this special edition of Vista Records Radio, where we have been looking at Y&T, a band that should have been huge. And if not huge, I think most of you would agree that at the very least, they should have had two or three gold albums, and they didn't, and that's largely because of their record company and maybe to a lesser degree to their management. But the band themselves, they were great, great albums, great live shows, and that's what they're going to be remembered for. So for Vista Records Radio, my name is Erik Rupp. I just wanted to say thank you for listening to the show, and we'll catch you on the next one. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.